I had the privilege of working with two Secretary Generals of the United Nations, Boutros Ghali and Kofi Annan, both of them late, and both of them Africa. And they came up with an agenda of a post-Cold War order. And Boutros Ghali wrote the famous Agenda for Peace, in which he argued that there can be no development without peace. He followed this up with another seminar report called An Agenda for Development, in which he argued, convincingly in my view, that there be no durable peace without sustainable development. And it was Kofi Annan in an agenda which he called Enlarger Freedom, in which he argued that there will neither be peace nor development without democracy, without the rule of law. And elections are the instrument for democracy, a necessary instrument, not the only instrument, but elections not for the sake of election, but for good governance. And also elections that are peaceful and that free of violence and they respect the will of the people. That's at the global level. Now, at the continental level, the African Union came up with Agenda 2063. Why 2063? Because then the AU, African Union, will be 1 year old from the time that the OAU, the Organization of African Unity, was established, by the way, incidentally, with major support from Nigeria. And they came up with this agenda in which one of the pillars is silencing the guns by the year 2020, which is next year, because they realize without silencing the guns, without ending conflict, without silencing the instruments of destruction, we will not have development and will not have the environment that will be conducive to the Africa that we want. What is the Africa that we want? Africa that is peaceful, that is prosperous, and in which people enjoy the right to choose the government under which they want to live. And that's why now, at the national level, we have to create the conditions for peace, for development, and also for the democratic aspirations of our people. But it's rather unfortunate that 20 years after military rule in Nigeria, we're still grappling with the basics. Restlessness among our people manifested in electoral violence, manifested in farmers-herders conflict, manifested in militancy, manifested in Boko Haram, above all. Some of these phenomena and the endemic insecurity are unheard of in the past. Whoever thought that Nigeria, would ever experience suicide bombers? We thought we love life too much. We even call our music high life. But it's happening. So we have to find out what is it that is responsible for this. What is it that is responsible? What are the root causes of the conflicts, some of which are very much unheard of? And in many ways, the sections of our national elite, you know, the political elite, they are like the Bourbons of France. We seem to have learned nothing and forgotten nothing. Because if we have learned something, if we have forgotten something, we will not very flippantly be sounding the trumpets of war. We will not be calling iPod and all of that, believing that war is the solution to our problems. It is not. And I'm here speaking in the citadel of the military. The people who hate war the most are the soldiers and the generals, because they know and they witness the kind of destructiveness that comes from war. So we have to ensure that our political elite learn from history. They must stop fanning the embers of hatred and animosity and ethnicity for selfish political and financial ends. Because such attitudes are not typical of nations that created strong national identity within its policy and among its people. It is the primary purpose of the Nigerian government to ensure the security of its citizens. This is stated in the 1999 Constitution, Section 14, Subsection 2 and B, that, and I quote, "The security and welfare of the people shall be the primary purpose of government." And how does the government deliver on this? It delivers on this by putting the responsibility to the military, the police, and other security agencies. And they have enormous responsibilities in tackling the various multifaceted security challenges facing our nations. If you add to that the rampant drug abuse, the proliferation of small arms that we use in skirmishes that promote violence, vendetta, robbery, banditry, deviance, petty crime, felony, really we seem to be swamped, but we cannot, because the monopoly of violence must not be in anybody's hand except the military and the police and other security agencies of the government. And therefore, because we are overtaxing the security agencies, we must not think that only they, you know, because sometimes we Nigerians, we tend to outsource our national responsibilities as citizens. So if we have a problem, let somebody else solve it. It's the security agencies. No. Yes, the security agencies have to be reformed. The security sector reform is critical. It's very important. But we cannot leave these responsibilities to them alone. Yes, we have to foster synergy among the security agencies, but we must give them the cooperation of the community, the cooperation of civil society organizations, so that we can get a clearer understanding of what are the root causes of conflict. Because in many ways, the root causes of conflicts are inequality, which is growing within the country, between countries, and lack of opportunities, youth unemployment, and I'm going to talk about that maybe later on in my presentation. And we have to really go do more and put resources in conflict resolution and peace building for the individual and society in general cannot be emphasized, because you can have the physical security of the state, but you can have the insecurity of the citizens. Therefore, we have to really aspire to build human security in all their dimensions: political security, economic security, environmental security, political security. These are all the elements that has to be tackled. And that is why the imperative for good governance, and I want to congratulate once again the new chairman of the African Peer Review Mechanism, the Governing Council, the National Governing Council, because at bottom, poor governance promotes conflicts. Poor governance, and governance is not just political good governance, economic, corporate, and social economic development. These are the pillars on which the African Peer Review Mechanism is built, and which our new chairman of the National Governing Council of NEPAD, and therefore of the APRM, is going to be preoccupied with. Now, the starting point is to, we've had so many conferences, so many summits, so we even had national conference, we have resolutions, we have reports. It's time to spend more time to look at those reports, bring them out, try to summarize, try to concretize, and above all, try to implement. And we must put dialogue at the center of resolving many of the conflicts that is facing our country. And dialogue and consultations must be inclusive and all-encompassing. Inclusivity contributes to the process of nation and still building, which remain unfulfilled parts of the national project. I want to state again and again that the sustainability of the Nigerian project for a united, peaceful, prosperous Nigeria cannot depend on one person. We can't say, let Buhari do it, let the military do it. It's the responsibility of all of us, and traditional rulers, religious leaders, civil society organizations, NGOs, and the ordinary people of Nigeria, we have to stand united and say no to violence, no to electoral violence, no to violent extremism, and yes to a peaceful, prosperous Nigeria, which is possible. And we must translate our potential as a nation into the reality, because our people cannot eat potential. We can't keep saying Nigeria is a potentially the most peaceful, powerful nation, black nation on earth. When will the potential become reality? It has happened in other countries. Singapore, for example, you in the lifetime of the founding father transformed from the fourth world to the first world. We have what it takes. We have the leadership of the international organization. We have the president of Security Council, president of General Assembly. In fact, next week, a Nigerian will be the president of the United Nations General Assembly. A Nigerian right now is the deputy secretary general of the United Nations. How come we bring peace to other countries? There'll be no Liberia today. There'll be no Sierra Leone today, but for the sacrifice of our Nigerian military and soldiers. You know, we were in Darfur creating peace. Why can we not do the same for our country and therefore translate our potentials into the reality for our people to really enjoy the fruits of what the Almighty has given us as our natural and mineral and other human resources? Let me conclude by appreciating the AUDA NEPAD APRM Nigeria, who in collaboration with the Nigerian Army, our pride as an institution. Please give a round of applause to the Nigerian Army. They are paying the ultimate sacrifice every day, you know. We are overutilizing them for what is even police duties. There's hardly any state in Nigeria where there are no Nigerian army or people calling for the Nigerian army to secure the peace and security of their community. So I feel so highly honored to chair today's session, and I already foresee robust ideas emanating from this discussion, which we believe will really help to solidify the synergy between the security agencies and other arms of our country present in addressing the security challenges facing Nigeria, because I want to say, not because I'm a Nigerian, but wherever Africa is going, Nigeria has to get there first. And so it's important for Nigeria to go in the right direction, because wherever Nigeria goes, the rest of Africa goes. And the rest of the world is looking to Nigeria to show the leadership. We must not fail the world. We must not fail Africa. We must not fail Nigeria. Thank you very much for listening.